What is going on, everybody? Today, I want to take you on a little space trip because life, you know, is this even real? What are we doing here? What's it all about? Stupid question. What are we doing here? We are practicing cards, of course. Welcome to another live practice magic session. Live card magic practice session here on my channel, OTHMARIUS MAGIC. Currently one viewer, probably that's statistics showing me viewing, because of course I'm viewing to check it out if it's working. Today is Tuesday, about 2:30 p.m. I'm broadcasting from Berlin, GMT plus one. What's up, everybody? I hope someone's tuning into the show today. I really don't care, actually, because of course I'm also doing this for myself, right? Using these sessions also to improve my own card handling, and also practicing handling cards and kind of, you know, interacting with people if people are showing up. Okay, we got Evie, moin, Evie. We got Melanie Magic, hey Melanie, what's up? And we got Brian Rapper tuning in again, psychedelic, yes. Today we're going to do this super psychedelic. I just, what can you say? I just accidentally listened to a very, very nice mixtape, you say, or playlist on my favorite music streaming site. And we're going to listen to some crazy psychedelic industrial space music in the background. And I'm seeing this is like right now totally overdosed here, so let me bring this down. Yeah, live streaming like a real professional. What's up, guys? Are you in a good mood? Are you having a good day so far? I am. I actually do. Very, very slowly everything today. And I'm really, really excited right now to get into a practice session with you guys. One more practice session. We have been covering a lot of material here on this stream so far, on these live card magic practice sessions. It's the 14th or 15th session I'm doing, and we covered really a lot of material. We started with the absolute basics, how to handle cards, the basic grips, how to spread cards. And then we talked about the necessity and importance of shuffling cards and cutting cards. And then we took a close look at the basic card control techniques. Also embedding flourishes, the five most valuable flourishes, into what we have learned so far. And at that point, a lot of elements, a lot of techniques started blending together into a real nice basic repertoire of card handling techniques in order to already perform some decent card magic, right? And then we talked about some specific card control sleights, or specific sleights in general. However, taking quite a close look at the past, the classic past, that's what we did too. And then we proceeded, we talked about performance aspects of the art form. We talked about how to master an art form in general, what it takes to become a magician. And we also took a look, or talked a little bit about the different kinds of practice that are out there, different practice phases, practice strategies, and so on. So there was quite a lot of stuff we did so far. And today I don't really want to go into any topic specifically. I just really want to go into a really focused practice session with you guys today. So get a deck of cards out if you can, and then you use this quality time, right? Listening to this as a podcast or watching to it, and at the same time practicing cards. Because if there's one thing that's true, we all need more practice, right? And we all are quite busy with our lives, whatever you guys are up to, studying, you've been in school, or you're having a job or a family or whatever, you know, life is quite busy, and practice time is something really, really valuable. So if you are spending a lot of time consuming so-called social media and watching YouTube clips, why you very well can also be practicing at the same time. I'm doing this all the time, quite honestly, when I'm watching YouTube. Some email just came in. Somebody is pleased. That's nice. Doing this all the time, watching YouTube, and at the same time practicing the things that I'm just practicing at that specific time. I'm always starting my day with a practice session, and I'm usually going through the shuffles, the basic shuffles, the overhand shuffle, just to get started, you know, to warm up. A couple of overhand shuffles, also Hindu shuffles, that's what I'm getting started with. Also, of course, the in-air, in-hands riffle. This failed. Guys, are you still watching? Like, four people commented something in the comments. And Plavon Pyrrhus, hey, awesome you're tuning in again. But YouTube is telling me that there's only one person viewing. What's going on? The stream quality should be all right. Of course, I'm also heading always very quickly after a few shuffles for some false shuffles. You can do with the overhand shuffle and with the Hindu shuffle. And also my favorite, my all-time favorite stand-up cuts, two-handed cuts. I'm usually practicing because this is the stuff I need all the time. So I want to really have it at my fingertips, no matter what comes up, no matter the situation, the surroundings. And that's how I start my day, with a cup of coffee, shuffling a little bit cards. Do you guys have practice routines like that? Do you start your days with cards, your days with cards? It says eight people watching right now. And maybe I gotta reboot my site here. It's weird, so weird. Awesome, for eight folks watching, I'm really, really excited about that. You know, at this point, my channel is still kind of cozy. OTHMARIUS MAGIC is about to hit. Yeah, now this looks better here. It's about to hit. Yeah, now it shows me also 8 current viewers. It's about to hit the 5K subscribers milestone about the end of December, which is awesome. So we're gonna start 2019 definitely with a little celebration, with a giveaway, and probably I make the promise right now, I'm going to give away a card magic starter set for 5K subs. 3 decks plus a close-up mat and 1 paperback version of the Royal Road to Card Magic. How does that sound? This whole package is going to be given away. We make a little contest at the beginning of 2019. This is how I'm planning to start it. In case the milestone is actually gonna be reached. And of course, next to the things, to the standard practice routines I got, of course also I'm throwing some flourishes in there, like the spring or the dribble or the thumb fan, different fanning techniques. Then of course, at a certain point, it's time to practicing the things to progress with everything, to keep it, to bring it to next level. And for me, for a very long time, that was the double lift and double turnover. Studied the technique a lot. This is a version I use very much, very lovely to use. And then of course the classic versions you will see a lot, something like this. Practice this a lot. Seemed very important to me for quite a long time. Now I got it, also the strike, double lift, double turnover. And now that I kind of got it at my fingertips, it's nice because it comes in handy very often. And of course I practice for a very long time. Still practicing also the pass and its variations. And by the way, guys, I've got tutorial series up and running for all these beautiful techniques. And for today's session, I put three or four playlists, I call them practice session playlists, into the info cards. You find it there in the on the other side. Oh man, I'm so stupid there, like there, you know, in the upper right corner of your screen, there are the info cards, and there you'll find these three practice playlists. And I put together something like a basic shuffle technique, like the overhand shuffle or the Hindu shuffle, and then a specific faults card, and then kind of a flourish. It's really good to practice kind of three to five things at the same time, you know, but always keep it balanced and always know what you're practicing for. But you are not doing anything wrong practicing the overhand shuffle or the Hindu shuffle and a nice flourish, right? EV writes, I've just been through the first chapter of Expert at the card table and I'm practicing the overhand shuffle constantly. Solid foundation of controlling cards, in my opinion. That is absolutely correct, absolutely. You know what, I'm probably going to do in the next live stream a session on the overhand shuffle, maybe also the Hindu shuffle and the basic false shuffling techniques we also find in the Royal Road to Card Magic. It's really cool stuff. Let's do this next time. Something like this, for example. This is how a bottom stock control looks like with the overhand shuffle. I do it like this. It's absolutely cool, keeping the bottom intact. Yeah, let's talk about this in the next session, however, because I'm not prepared yet, and because I like to, you know, give you some thoughts and insights. And I usually, before I start streaming, I'm sitting down and then I'm, you know, writing my thoughts onto a sheet of paper. It's a weird time for me to do this, actually. Like 2:15 to 3 p.m. Berlin time. Usually around that time I'm doing something else instead of sitting at the card table. But as I told you last session, Christmas season is coming at us and we are very, very busy with something else I'm involved in, another project. And pretty much I'm working all day. And then my practice time is in the morning, at the beginning of the day, or in the evening, at the end of the day. So I'm kind of a morning night guy. And then, like, in the middle of the day, sitting here and practicing cards and doing also live streaming, it kind of feels awkward right now. I don't know why. Brian Rapid writes, how do you decide when you know something enough to not have to worry about taking dedicated time to practice? That's a good question. I think you just know it, right? Kind of. Of course, you will always be practicing, especially the things that turn out to be valuable to you. You know, there might be some techniques and a certain style, and automatically, kind of naturally, you rely on that, and you say, and that's you just like using it. It works for you, and you will probably, this is what will go or turn into your basic fundamental practice routine, that thing that you then at a certain level you just takes you 15 minutes or something, and you've been through it because you know it and you can do it. But you keep it, of course, fresh. You got to keep it legit. You got to keep it really at your hands. And then there's a comparison with the things that you can't do. You know, you exactly know when you attempt using something, that's not really all there. And then that's when you start getting nervous about showing it, you know. So, let me refresh the page here again. Oh, guys, I totally forget to hit you with my channel trailer today, but it doesn't matter, right? This is a live stream. Everything's live here. So, while the page is refreshing, hey, guys, how you doing? You got something going on in the chat? Okay. I'm really excited about these live streams. It's a lot of fun to do them. I got it all set up. And really, this is a really good practice for me because the future tutorials that I'm about to shoot, especially the table work, I'm going to shoot with this setting. So this practice here, that really helps, you know, to get a feel for the cameras and for the angles so that I will be able to shoot pretty efficiently these upcoming tutorials on all the table work and also some performances. Although I'm more a stand-up guy, because this is where I usually perform, you know. Got a deck of cards at me, and then at the bar, people standing. This is where I'm confronted with the performance situation most of the time. So I decided to really get material at my hands to be locked and ready when an opportunity opens up, right? So very well then, my children. I wanna space away with you and really get into some practice here. So I will shut up for a little bit, turn the music up a little bit, and then you guys, if you have the time, you might join me here, really getting into some serious practice. Because so far I've been talking all the time. Last stream, the last stream, the upload didn't really work. So after one third of the stream, audio video gets unsynced. It's not sync anymore. Maybe it's just happening on my player. I don't know. Sometimes things like that happen, you know. Yeah. Okay, then let me show you what I want to show you, actually, because this is some weird thing that I heard yesterday, and it was so cool. I'm gonna turn this on right now, and then I really start practicing, guys. do this a little differently here today. I need it right now. I don't feel like being so punctuated, so really, you know, in a mood for communication. I really need to get my thoughts ordered. So I start practicing cards now while we are going to listen to this freaky, freaky music. Planets.
The entire earth is but a point, and the place of our own habitation but a minute corner of it, said Marcus Aurelius, the Roman emperor, around 170. As the astronomers unanimously teach, the circuit of the whole earth, which to us seems endless, compared with the greatness of the universe, has the likeness of a mere tiny point, said Ammianus Marcellinus, the last major Roman historian. This is how the planets would look to an alien spaceship approaching the solar system after a long interstellar voyage. From this distance, the planets seem only points of light. They are like the planets seen with the naked eye from the surface of the Earth, luminous dots, brighter than most of the stars. You cannot tell merely by looking at one of these dots what it's like, what's on it, what its past has been, and whether, in this particular epoch, anyone lives there. Consider again that dot. That's here. That's home. That's us. On it, everyone you love, everyone you know, everyone you ever heard of, every human being who ever was, lived out their lives. The aggregate of our joy and suffering. Thousands of confident religions, ideologies, and economic doctrines. Every hunter and forager, every hero and coward, every creator and destroyer of civilization. Every king and peasant, every young couple in love, every mother and father, hopeful child, inventor and explorer. Every teacher of morals, every corrupt politician, every superstar, every supreme leader, every saint and sinner in the history of our species lived there, on the mote of dust, suspended in a sunbeam. The Earth is a very small stage in a vast cosmic arena. Think of the rivers of blood spilled by all those generals and emperors so that in glory and triumph they could become the momentary masters of a fraction of a dot. Think of the endless cruelties visited by the inhabitants of one corner of this pixel on the scarcely distinguishable inhabitants of some other corner. How frequent their misunderstandings, how eager they are to kill one another, how fervent their hatreds. Our posturings, our imagined self-importance, the delusion that we have some privileged position in the universe, are challenged by this point of pale light. Our planet is a lonely speck in the great enveloping cosmic dark. In our obscurity, in all this vastness, there is no hint that help will come from elsewhere to save us from ourselves. The Earth is the only world known so far to harbor life. There is nowhere else, at least in the near future, to which our species could migrate. Visit? Yes. Settle? Not yet. Like it or not, for the moment, The earth is where we make our stand. There is perhaps no better demonstration of the folly of human conceits than this distant image of our tiny world. To me, it underscores our responsibility to deal more kindly with one another and to preserve and cherish the pale blue dot, the only home we've ever known.
What a trip. This is one of the most powerful productions I can think of. This is for laymen, absolutely, absolutely out of reach. All right, Brian Rappert. Thanks for tuning in. See you around next time. It's a little crazy session I'm doing here right now, but it's live, isn't it? Take care, buddy. Magic practice session on OTHMARIUS MAGIC. Take a deck of cards out and start practicing, guys. We all need practice. That's such a beautiful flourish. Absolutely fantastic. Come on. Also, by the way, I'm using this camera angle that you are watching right now here as a reference for myself. Really looking what I'm doing. And then of course checking how it looks from my perspective, from the magician's point of view. And then adjusting these two different perspectives. And then trying to completely memorize everything. Every tiny motion of the fingers. The whole feeling of the body. And the challenge, of course, is to make the illusion as perfect as possible. And right now I'm seeing something I don't like. And I don't know how to actually fix this. Because I'm going bang, and then I'm going back. Oh, it's okay, isn't it? Also, what you're seeing right now, although you're not seeing it right now, is I'm starting to connect dots here, to put elements together. Working my way up to a more complex flow of motions. So this was a very terrible interruption, and that also, of course. But when you're practicing, don't be too eager. Keep a little amusement for yourself in it. Be playful with the cards. Be like water. And then there's also something. Right now you don't see me checking whether what I'm doing works or not, because I kind of know, yeah? So I don't waste my time practicing certain techniques and then always checking, are the four aces still on top of the deck or not? That's a waste of time. Failure. So let's piece this baby together here. Would look something like this. Okay. Walk through number two. Get you some relaxing for the muscles here. So two folks viewing right now, I hope you are practicing. Raven Sixon. Raven Sixon writes, hello, I spent 2 years in Berlin. It's a beautiful city. Yeah, it's a beautiful city. Although we're just now in the late spring, winter's coming fast, and then Berlin gets dark and gray usually. But in the summer, it's sexy. It's a really beautiful city. But now it's getting also crowded here, you know, like 10 years ago, there weren't so many people living in the city, and it's a really wide architecture. It's a huge city, and you know, you have only 3.5 million people in a huge city. It felt very comfortable, you know, the public transportation, super mellow, super easy, traffic, just fine. You could walk the streets almost by yourself at night. But now it's getting crowded. More and more people shuffling in every day. Where are you from, Raven Sixon? And why did you live for 2 years in Berlin? I'm curious, let me know. If you want to share, that is, of course. And by the way, welcome to this card magic practice session. This is the 14th or 15th session that I'm doing, practicing cards with you guys together, making this a quality time. Being on YouTube, interacting with you guys watching something, and also practicing cards, hopefully. So. Oh my God, what did I just do? Jason's through the world here. Guys. It's practice time on OTHMARIUS MAGIC.
OTHMARIUS MAGIC. Like and subscribe.
So, currently 4 people viewing. We're doing a little spaced out, space tripping meditation style kind of card practice session. So if you're into the mood, join me. Get a deck of cards out. Put yourself in pole position and start practicing some cards or some coins or some sponge balls or whatever it is you're practicing. You know? Because we all need some practice. Am I right? Ooh, it's a fan. Backhand fan? Like this. Ooh, it's a spring. Guys, we're a cozy community here on my channel, which is about to hit 5,000 subscribers end of December, approximately. It's great. It's crazy. I love it because I really can interact with you guys, whoever shuffles in and feels like commenting something. You know, one fine day, OTHMARIUS MAGIC is going to have 5 million subs, and then you have to pay $50 for a comment to stay 3 seconds up. I'm telling you this. But when that happens, in case that ever happens, we're going to move on to Patreon, aren't we? And then we do some private sessions there. Huh? Sounds great. But for now, and it's pretty cool about my channel, high quality magic related content, very, very close, very, very intimate. Awesome, isn't it? Okay, Raven 6-1 was at the army. Base with tanks. I don't know where's an army base here. I know, so probably from the United States, right? You guys got army bases all over the world and also all over Europe. Amazing. Where is it, man? The other day I was driving through a smaller village or town in Germany, and there was a huge army base. Yeah, it's requisite souvenirs from the Second World War. Oh boy. Our grandfathers, they were just not cool with each other. Oh my God. I'm so glad we got this technology today where we can interact and come together over borders, cross nations, and sharing our passion, sharing knowledge, getting into debates and discussion, and hopefully making the world a better, a more peaceful place. Okay. So in 1990 and 92, shortly after the wall came down in 89. That must have been crazy times. I'm living in Berlin since 2000 only. It's 18 years now. Oh God, almost 19 years. You still see the damage in the city from the World War. How you say, gun holes, holes in the walls from all the gunfighting in the streets. Vega Dub tuning in, writing. First of all, hey Vega Dub, awesome you're tuning in. It's right, you're writing, who do my cards fan very well when I take them out of the box, but then after playing with them for 2 minutes, they don't fan well and stick in small packets. I don't know what kind of cards you're using. They should fan a little longer than 2 minutes. Maybe your technique isn't that improved. However, it is happening that when you're using cards longer than 2 minutes, because of the sweat and moisture of your fingers and hands, the cards become sticky, and then they don't feel so nice anymore, and don't handle very well anymore. And then when you put them in a box and you keep them there for a day or 2 days and they come out again, everything feels like renewed. So that's why usually if you are working a lot with cards and practicing a lot, I'm working with this deck right now, and also a tally-ho. And it's like kind of a shift, I want to say. The ones that are getting older, I'm using them for more rough stuff, and the newer ones I'm using for the more delicate techniques. And it really depends on what you're doing. Sometimes a little bit more sticky deck than a really brand new deck, a really slippery deck, comes in more handy or plays more comfortable. As a matter of fact, for the double lift, for example, you know. But then, when you want to do kind of slip cuts and false deals or steals, the cuts can't be slippy enough. So it's always a question of what you're about to pull off. But usually, because this is a myth out there, you know, cards are lasting much longer than I've heard a lot of people saying. There's people, they say that a deck isn't workable anymore after a week of heavy use. I mean, I don't know. I can hardly imagine somebody being using the cards more heavy than I do. Yeah, of course. There are probably people that do not sleep and do not eat and do not have a social life and do not need to work to get the money in, and they have 24/7 cards in their hands, maybe. But still then, in a week, no way. I have decks for months, using them for months, for years. And they turn out pretty ugly then, you know, the sides are... Let me show you this with maybe this tally-ho. Sides become really, really ugly. Do you see that? Let me show you this with this camera. Look at this. Dirty and ugly. Oh, that's a nice picture for a thumbnail, for the next thumbnail. No, make it again like how it was. It was in the back, it was not sharp, and in the front it was sharp, like this. Come and tune in to OTHMARIUS MAGIC live stream, because it's awesome.
OTHMARIUS MAGIC. Like and subscribe.
So, that's that. Let's play the meme for the day. So, now let's do some of these bad boys. Already looking so good. Oh. Evie asks me, what can you give me for doing the classic, what advice can you, what tips can you give me for doing the classic pass in front of spectator for the first time? We have been doing overhand shuffles to control for quite some time now. You shall not pass. You've seen that, you shall not pass. Did you see that, shall not pass? Livestream, I guess. Hashtag you shall not pass. Well, you know, yeah, just do it. Just give it a try. The only thing you got to consider is that the pass is something where, as being unexperienced, you tend to focus on when you do it. So you have your pattern or your routine, and then at the moment the closer you come to the pass, the more your focus goes to this motion, you know. And this is what spectators do sense. And the key to it is to just pull the pass off casually, just at the moment when you look up from the cards to the spectator, and you have a lot of time there. There's a little secret here in between. You might have heard about dead spots of the visual view, and this is something really, really true. You cannot believe how much we actually don't see when we're focusing on something else, and especially when we shift our attention from one visual field to another visual field, there's a lot of data loss, which the brain then reconstructs a split second afterwards. Nanosecond, we're talking nanoseconds here, but it's still enough. So when you do the pass, and with this angle here, you totally see it. This is how I would do it. I say, here's your card, the 10 of hearts, right? And it stays right there in the deck. Now I look up, and where I look up, I just do this motion. And then it's done. And in the moment where you look up, the people usually look up. And if they don't look up, you know, you are still in this situation. And you look up, and they don't look up, well, you just square up the cards and stay there, and then you're in this position. And as soon as they look up, you just make the pass. Boom, there you go, done. So the key to it is to not be nervous about it. And the pass is not meant to have the spectators look at it. And that's the thing. It's not, the pass is not something you want your spectators looking at the cards or at your hands while you do it. It's just quite the opposite. You know, and in that sense, there is no invisible pass, although there is something like the cover pass, and there are techniques. You can actually, to a certain angle, within the range of a certain angle or perspective, you can perform a pass with the people looking at their hands and cover it in a certain way. But that's not the main goal. The first thing is to understand this real, to understand what's going on in a real performance situation. When you go like this, bang, now I missed it. That would have caused trouble during a performance, but I'm going like this, bang, done. And you see this from this angle here. I got a camera standing right here. This is something I would never use to control a card. You can do it much more easier. For example, we have on top the jack of spades here. Okay, we lose the jack of spades in the deck, that's what we do, and then we just cut the cards onto the table, deck is shuffled and mixed, and everything's fine, you know, and you achieve the same thing. And for layman, it's not a difference, and it's not something, pass is not something usually you use or you for a visual effect or something, you know, to make a card appear. That's what you would do in a combination. So in the same way, what we just did, we have the, I just do this again. So we have the, no, let me do it like this. So we have the Jack of Spades, the spectator card. I shuffle the card. I even have a spectator stop me at any time, and I put all the cards in there. And then I would say, look, Wouldn't it be amazing that also that even after shuffling the cards, wouldn't it be amazing if the Jack of Spades comes to the top of the deck? Oh no, it didn't. It didn't come to the top of the deck. And then you just do something like this, boom, and that comes the Jack of Clubs to the top of the deck. And then it's for a spectator completely mind blowing. So the Jack now appeared on the deck out of the blue. And this is just one example of not getting nervous about one specific move in there and putting all the reliability on that specific move. What you want to do is build a routine or perform a trick where the secret is embedded into different elements, you know, into the plot of the trick, into the setup of the trick, so that when you do a specific slide, like the pass, like to get a stock or a card to the top, there's not much pressure on it because it's part of the whole thing. And in that behalf, of course, you can just try, I mean, just go to strangers and try to perform the pass. The simplest thing, just, you know, it's a little bit of abuse, but you just try this thing and say, look, I've got your card here, you know, closes up, look up, see when he looks up, make the pass, and yet, in just a moment, it comes to the top. Or did I bring it to the bottom now? You know, I got the hearts on the bottom and the diamonds on top. And then you perform the trick, and if it doesn't work, and I mean, It's not now or never. There are situations where it's now or never. Like if you walk on stage on Penn and Teller or something, you should be pretty sure about what you're doing. Or on a bigger stage, you know, where. But if you just are on a one-on-one situation with someone random in not a specific. Very important situation, give it a try and make the experience, no? And if you want to play safe, and that's what I'm always saying, get the basics of card control, the basic card control handlings down. By that I mean catching a pinky break in the first place, but using an in-jog, using the shuffle or the chalier card or the thumb fan, and then catch the break and learn cutting the deck. And then there's plenty of tricks where you can embed this technique, use this technique and practice. And because from the performance situation, it's the same thing. You will need the experience of how people react and how big your opportunity windows actually are in the performance situation. And if you get, if you get only a little of experience, you will find this gap where you put the pass in. And then as soon as you make this first experience, you're going to be so relaxed after that. You know, that's really. It's not so crazy, like they all say. So you keep asking. Here, where is it? Where is the comments? Pretty down here, down, dude. I gotta learn this. There's the comment. Do you think I need an extra misdirection at first, or is looking them in the eyes enough? Yeah, it's not about making the pass invisible, only about shifting the spectator's attention to something else. Yeah, so that nicely put. That's it. Now, you don't need any other misdirection, basically. There is this misdirection. It's like this. This is a field on its own. It's something very, very exciting, and it's really there's a lot of psychology and knowledge about. Psychological behavior and behavior patterns and reaction patterns playing all into this whole thing. But there's this huge misconception about misdirection. No, let me put it like this. On a very early stage, you might think misdirection is like pointing somewhere else, and then people look away, and then you do your thing, you know. And here's the crazy thing: that's exactly what misdirection is. Of course, it's so much more subtle when you do it, because the real misdirection is something people do not realize happening at all. And the first rule, or one of the ingredients for this magic formula, is to have meaningful, but to behave meaningful and reasonable from your onlooker's point of view. So when you look up from a deck, when you look to a deck really weirdly down to the deck, people will not really look. They will look at the deck because it's really strong, but they still will be like, "What is he doing now?" Or if you look away from the deck at a point where naturally the attention actually lies to the deck, you will find spectators confused. They will be at the decks and then they will look at you and they will go like, "Why is he looking at me? What is going on here?" But at the moment, so you have a deck, you have a card, you'll have the spectator select the card, and at the point where you put the deck into the cards, and now I come back and I look to you, this is really natural. And then in this whole motion, I do the pass, and it gets completely out of sight it's not in the visual field, so to say, and not in the psychological field, and it's very natural then. And as soon as I pack the cards together, it's done for the spectator. The cards are lost, and so you proceed. And now, with this little explanation, I lost all the current viewers, because this is something they don't want to hear. They want to hear how the cool guys do it, you know, the invisible pass, it's just all focused on the hands today, with this new form of magical presentation that comes with social media, that comes with everybody having a camera. And I'm saying this all the time, guys, it's super cool to have these music video, MTV music video compilation clips of cool cardistry moves and stuff. I love that, but it is not representative for what is happening really in the world, you know? And you do not get the same effect of cutting awesome moves after one another in a live performance situation, never. So when you come to a spectator, to an audience, and you do, I don't know, less pulse spread, and you do these flirty things, and people will react like this. At least if you're dealing with grown-ups, with people that are actually expecting something, a deal, a bargain from a social interaction, they will go like, "Yeah, okay." and you go, it's not worth. It has no worth. Okay, so this is what you need to know. And I know the kids, they don't want to hear it, but they're gonna make this. They will make the experience. Don't waste the time practicing difficult things that are not worth for anything. Except making cool YouTube videos or cool trailers. God damn it! Lost everybody. I hope I could answer your question, Evie. So, and I'm always using, this is what I'm very often do, like this. I didn't get it, but like something like this, the dribble pass, where I embed the pass into this dribbling motion. This goes completely undetected, usually, and it leaves me with this nice notion. And I'm doing it like this. I'm looking up and then I'm looking down while I'm doing it. So it would be something like this in this situation. Here's the card, I go in, I look up, I come down, I make the dribble, and then I just hit another dribble on top of there. And that's it, and I wouldn't go, and I play this like it's completely bypassed, like completely, I'm just doing this in between, anyways. Although, that is also not recommended, you gotta be very careful with stuff like that. And I'm a huge fan of Aaron Fischer's card handling style. The less that is happening with the cards, the better, right? But if you play into this direction, here come gaff decks, gimmicks, and other techniques like self-working thing or mathematical principle quite in handy to use. And again, maybe a blend is the best thing. I'm still focusing on sleight of hand based stuff. I just like that. I love it so much. It's just a challenge to get these moves going and to understand the cards and to handle cards like that with this with finesse. That's just my thing. There's no need for difficult or heavy sleight of hand for great card magic. And they should be as defined and as little and as exquisite of presentation of skill as possible, you know? Dude, I don't know what digression has. Heist. Now I'm speaking Dinglish. I need to Google digression right now. Digression.
OTHMARIUS.
Okay, I got it. I was talking a lot, right? So now I don't know. Probably I got the trailer on. When I switch here the angles, doesn't matter so much. So, this is something. Now I'm dealing with here, getting this notion of the fingers of my left hand under control. The rest of the thing here is pretty accurate, but you still got this flapping on my fingers, and that is what I just need to get under control. Now I have a strategy for this, but I'm not absolute. But I just will need to practice a lot. And this is flashing like crazy because I don't have my index finger of the left hand under control. And you clearly can see this motion, which I want to hide. And I don't know if this is an angle thing or a camera thing, but I just want to get this out of the way right where I'm at. So I wanna hide the fingers, and then I have them like that. And this is now what I said the other day, the hardest part after getting a general idea of all the motions, turning on your camera, and then like basically going a lot of step backwards, slowing down again, and really defining the motion and seeing what is not working. And then you get this angled sensibility, and you get this really, really this understanding of what is happening. And then you have to practice, and you practice, and to do it again and again, and eventually there's going to be the moment where you go like, ah, that's it, I gotta change this now, and I gotta change this now. Before you speed up things again. And I really don't have any clue how to get this index finger here under control right now. Right now it feels like that I have to change the whole way of doing it by just bringing the second finger into another wipe. Sorry guys. You see this? This flipping of the index finger, it makes me crazy. It probably can mean that I just don't have the muscles built up, or the dexterity of this defined muscle motions here. I don't have it down yet, and that's why the index finger is ticking out. And I wanna get this move like without the index finger ticking. I realize now this is what I'm aiming at here, absolutely crucial. And this is something I will only be able to practice with a camera. There it goes. Why? Ah, it's so frustrating. Maybe the grip is not perfect. Try to to do this a little faster and see what's happening, and it's absolutely unsatisfying. I hate this right now. And then this, yeah, so it gotta be like this. Oh god, this is going to be so difficult. Why can't I see this all of a sudden? So also the little angle sensibility here. Now this is probably also not a camera angle. That represents really an angle of a spectator, I wonder. Gotta figure this out. Also, this is one of these things. Keeping the second, third, and fourth fingers together most of the time, whatever you do. Or have it under control, because if you just hold it like this all the time, it looks unnatural. So to be able to get into this position all the time and let loose when necessary, you know, it's not something you practice, right? I never practiced this. But it should come along the way, I wonder. That's crazy. The suckers. So I'm really down with this one. And took me also long like this, like doing this Leonard Green thing. Absolutely cool. Bang, go away. I'm just going to shuffle all these cards onto the table. I have a very, very funny idea. I have a funny idea for two nice performances with this. It's gonna be amazing. I'm looking forward to, let's give this a little close up here. Looking forward doing this, shooting these tutorials, not tutorials, performances. Gonna be amazing. I'm already there. I'm not 100% satisfied, but I'm already pretty close there. Yeah. Looks much better when looks much better with the cards upside, but now they are in. Now they have a little. They are bent a little bit inwards, which happens naturally working cards, and then this becomes a little difficult. Such a cool thing, and just what you saw me practicing before. this phase of really figuring out what's going on and really getting this down. I walked through with this also. And it was a crazy long and a very exhausting practice session, but now that I got it, now it's just a matter of of persistence and continuity. Just gotta keep practicing to really, 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 really get this down. Awesome, Brian Rappert, you're back. Sorry, missed a lot. Can you say again what kind of activities you use a camera for, given the limits of detail audience can often take in during live performances? Wait, I don't know. Sorry, missed a lot. Can you say again what kinds of activities you use? You use a camera for giving the limits of detail audience can often take in during live performances. I don't know if I really get what you're asking. There's in general a difference, a huge difference between working with a camera or full camera. Because cameras tend to go out. but real people also. No, there's a huge difference because a camera, you know, a camera kind of represents a stage situation. So it's a controlled setting. You exactly know the point of view and the limits of this view, and if you adjust the angles, you can make things look incredibly cool, although they are from a lot of other angles not working. What we do, of course, for a live situation, for a close-up live situation, we try to work out the solutions for the effects we want to present that are working in pretty much a complete surrounded situation, and sometimes with cool effect it's not possible, and then you have to learn to bring yourself in the right position for what you want to do, or using something like the pass, you learn about the limits of the human eye, or the limitation or the blind spots of the human perspective, where you place these sneaky little moves or dirty works like the pass or whatever, and people just don't see it because they're looking somewhere else, you know, or a deck switch, for example. You got a camera burning. Other things are possible than in a live situation. Other things are more difficult, like you cannot use misdirection on a camera, can you? So I'm using the camera, of course, when it comes to something like I just showed you. This is these are false dealing techniques, and of course when I'm dealing down the cards, usually you look down and you go like 1, 2, 3, 4, is these your cards, there you go, the cards 1, 2, 3, 4, and this is where people are looking at their hands, right? So first of all, what I do, this is my practice here, my just let me walk you through how to practice this. You first learn the real deal, you know, so you first learn how to, this is how it would look like dealing the cards, right? Something like this, whatever. Now you want to deal the cards from the bottom, you want to deal the cards from the second off the top, you want to not place the cards onto the table, whatever it is. Now you have to keep that in mind. This is how it's got to look like. Then you know this is that's how high the bar is. And then you start with the technique, with the specific technique, and first you got to figure it out, and everything looks crap and shit, and you don't even know, you know, how long it will take to be able to actually push a card from bottom like this, and you do this like this, like constantly, without, you know, without it, everything falling everywhere. It takes a long time. Pushing two cards at the top of the deck aside like one takes a long time to do this like in a fluent motion, yeah. And then you start practicing, and then you get to some results at a certain point, and then you turn on the camera, and then you look, and then you see, okay, you can see it because of me lifting the card up here, and there's this flapping motion, or you can see the knuckles going down. And then you gotta figure out, is this an angle? Is this an angle problem? Is this an angle situation? Or do I just don't have the technique at my tips right now? I'm too stressed. I can do this easier, and then it blends into the motion. And then these things you gotta figure out then. And then usually it's bring things up to speed, taking a look at it, realizing, okay, the index finger is flipping or something, going back, trying to figure fix the problem, and then speeding things up again. And then you progress in that manner, you know? And of course, the larger motion covers the smaller one, and the fast motion kind of covers the bigger one. But you do not. So with a certain technique, bringing things up to speed, you can get to a decent result for the human eye. But do not make the mistake bringing a shitty handling or a not perfect execution of the technique to speed, because then it really gets harder to get this bad habit under control, to lose the bad habit again, you know, to make it better. And also these are two different indicators. Does it work with the audience? Does it work with the people? Or does the illusion really look smashing? Is the illusion really working, you know? And that this is like, what do I mean by this? The illusion is what you really see and experience, and sometimes delusion is not 100% perfect, and you still get away with the effect, because in a life situation, people are usually processing a lot of stuff, and they are not, and they don't know what they are looking for, or what they would have to look for. And of course, we as magicians do, you know. So we are often focused on very tiny details that are not so relevant, actually, or so much big of a deal on a larger scale and with a real performance situation. I often seen that older magicians or working magicians showing a performance, and they have a certain sleight in there, a pass or a double lift, and what they do works, and they know it. They've done it for thousand times. And you see it by the reaction of the audience. People are entertained, people are stunned. And then you have these comments. This double lift sucks. Or he should better practice his pass before he goes out performing. And then you have this awkward situation of people commenting who think they know something about the art, just because they've been practicing the pass for 8 years, but have never been out there actually gaining experience as a performer, versus an old school magician who's doing this for freaking 40 years in bars, at tables, on the streets. and that's just a generation conflict. But one thing you can be sure of, when you get something working for the camera, this will definitely work out there with the human eye. So I've been talking a lot again here. Let me hit you one more time with the trailer, guys, and then I will go into a very focused practice session here again, giving you here a close up, really showing you that this is real, and I'm not just talking something. Although I just want you guys, I want you, please, at this point, I'm saying there's three people watching currently. Thank you so much for tuning in. Everything I say, take this as only, but rightfully, as an inspiration, as an input or impulse for your own thought process. Do not take it as the last word or something, yeah? This is all work in progress, and this is just me practicing what I love doing and trying to get to the best results, and also sharing this insight, which we could never do before in this kind of open white space together, to motivate you and maybe also to open your eyes for what is real in contrast to what is a production. And a lot of things you see, a lot of things we are confronted with, which seem to be authentic, are productions. You know, are actually products being advertised or brands being built. And this can burn you out because you are confronted all the time with this high level stuff, with things that look so amazing, that are so great, and at the same time the people who do it, they claim to be just doing it, it's part of the show, but there is so much work behind it, there's so much devotion to behind it, so much practice. And I just want to share this with you guys. I just want you to see this for our own sake, you know, because this is what we love. It's a beautiful art form. And even maybe magic is not your main thing. Pretty much this is true for all everything we do in life. You know, you can think about learning for school. Think about progressing in your professional field. Think about relationships. Or any other skill you're interested in, there's always this balance between what is the goal you vision for yourself and what amount of work and practice is required to achieve this goal. And to get this real, this really helps a lot to keep a good vibe, you know. I love this. I love cards. The practice time I spend is the time I just enjoy so much. It's just my thing, I guess. And I'm happy. I'm very happy that I found this passion. It's a psychedelic ride here today. Oh. Okay, so let's go back to the beginning and just listen. Let's listen together to this, whatever it is. Such a freaky thing. Here it comes.
The entire earth is but a point, and the place of our own habitation but a minute corner of it, said Marcus Aurelius, the Roman emperor, around 170. As the astronomers unanimously teach, the circuit of the whole earth, which to us seems endless, compared with the greatness of the universe, has the likeness of a mere tiny point, said Ammianus Marcellinus, the last major Roman historian. This is how the planets would look to an alien spaceship approaching the solar system after a long interstellar voyage. From this distance, the planets seem only points of light. They are like the planets seen with the naked eye from the surface of the Earth, luminous dots, brighter than most of the stars. You cannot tell merely by looking at one of these dots what it's like, what's on it, what its past has been, and whether in this particular epoch anyone lives there. Consider again that dot. That's here. That's home. That's us. On it, everyone you love, everyone you know, everyone you ever heard of, every human being who ever was, lived out their lives. the aggregate of our joy and suffering. Thousands of confident religions, ideologies, and economic doctrines. Every hunter and forager, every hero and coward, every creator and destroyer of civilization, every king and peasant, every young couple in love, every mother and father, hopeful child, inventor and explorer, every teacher of morals, every corrupt politician, every superstar, every supreme leader, every saint and sinner in the history of our species lived there, on the mote of dust, suspended in a sunbeam. The Earth is a very small stage in a vast cosmic arena. Think of the rivers of blood spilled by all those generals and emperors so that in glory and triumph they could become the momentary masters of a fraction of a dot. Think of the endless cruelties visited by the inhabitants of one corner of this pixel on the scarcely distinguishable inhabitants of some other corner. How frequent their misunderstandings. How eager they are to kill one another. How fervent their hatreds. Our posturings, our imagined self-importance, the delusion that we have some privileged position in the universe, are challenged by this point of pale light. Our planet is a lonely speck in the great enveloping cosmic dark. In our obscurity, in all this vastness, there is no hint that help will come from elsewhere to save us from ourselves. The Earth is the only world known so far to harbor life. There is nowhere else, at least in the near future, to which our species could migrate. Visit? Yes. Settle? Not yet. Like it or not, for the moment, the Earth is where we make our stand. There is perhaps no better demonstration of the folly of human conceits than this distant image of our tiny world. To me, it underscores our responsibility to deal more kindly with one another and to preserve and cherish the pale blue dot, the only home we've ever known.
So guys, my channel is going to hit the 5k subscribers milestone about the end of December. I just want to let you know, with you currently five folks viewing, there's going to be a beautiful opening in 2019 after the Christmas season and New Year's Eve. I'm going to give away a card magic starter pack, three decks of cards, a close-up map, and a paperback version of the Royal Road to Card Magic. So you make sure to hit that subscribe button and also that notification bell icon next to the subscribe button in order to get notified. And then you don't miss the show, right? I'm spacing away here at my card table. On the edge. On the brink of mastering this beautiful shuffling and cutting routine. And also next year there's going to be a tutorial series on these basics of table work. Featuring, of course, here the table riffle with special focus on the needs of magicians. And then there's going to be also these three cuts here. Embedded into the tutorial series, this one, and also the beautiful up to the ladder. Also, I'm going to show you how to perform a nice and easy ribbon spread with this beautiful flourish, and how to deal cards like a pro with special needs, with focus on special needs of magicians, of course, here again. And it's going to be a pretty awesome series. And maybe, how do you do this? Like when you show cards like this, you go like this. Okay, like this, you're here, you would go like this. No, it's like this. Here, showing the card, let me show this, how would this be done. And then I just turn the cards around like this, right. And I got it. No, I didn't got it. Let's do this again. How would I, how? Like this, four of clubs, like this. I'm here, ha, 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 ha. I'm here, and I got it. Yes. Gotta do this for the table. Gotta do this, of course. I haven't been using this really, so I just remember it, this version of it, and this is pretty much also the angle from a spectator's point of view, and you need to use your whole body in a way to get this legitimate. But it's a really nice one. Practicing this a little bit. Maybe I'm giving you also a tutorial on this one. It's really cool. There you go. Nine of diamonds. Nine of spades. Okay. Oh, the ace. So now let's make it good with the ace. Ah, shit! I flashed. Jesus! What's wrong with me? Beautiful. Beautiful move. So I need to set this right there like this. This is how it would be. Back. Nice. This is so nice. Also, coming up, tutorial series on my favorite card productions. Just like that. It's a beautiful one. Of course, then this magical one where the card comes out of the deck, rising out of the deck like this. Look at this. There it comes. There was two.
It's also very nice production. Booty, 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 booty. Cup, cup, cup. Then, of course, the pop-up, which is my absolutely favorite. There you go. Gotta practice this a little more. It's also something you can use stand-up, of course, and people really, really enjoy this. You know, produce four aces like this and boom, ah! People go nuts, bananas! Alrighty, right. Guys. We are doing this now for 1 hour and 36 minutes. I'd love to stay longer, but as a matter of fact, right now it's now 4 p.m. 7 minutes. 4 and 7 minutes p.m. Berlin time, GMT plus 1. An early hour session for me, at least, because usually I'm practicing cards at the end of the day and at the morning, at the beginning of the day, a little set of half an hour to 1 hour, and then a couple of hours at night. And then at my free days, of course, all day. And I'm having my practice routines the morning. My basic stuff, stuff I use all the time, and then I'm of course working specifically on things I want to shoot in the future, like these tutorials I just talked about, and also there's some really nice performances coming up, and all is going down 2019 on my channel, Marius Magic. So I gotta go now. Thank you so much for tuning in today. You are rocking awesome. I had a blast of a time. We did a little spaced out version of the Card Magic live jam here today. If you wanna now, if you wanna keep on watching, in the info cards, up in the info cards, my hand, up in the info cards, you will find the playlist for the live streams we did so far. Also three or four practice session playlists, and then also the playlist on the classic pass, on the pass, if you want to learn the pass, if you don't know it already. And then, of course, feel free to browse my channel page, OTHMARIUS MAGIC, on YouTube. There's a lot of tutorials and also performances available. And Hans de Goyet writes right now, thank you from Holland. Holland, hey man. Awesome. You're welcome. You're very welcome. Thanks for tuning in. I hope you're a subscriber. If not, I'd love to welcome you as a new subscriber to my channel. Also hit that notification bell if you hit that subscribe button, because the notification bell is the new subscribe button on YouTube. This is the only way to get guaranteed notifications, because if you only subscribe to a channel on YouTube, the new uploads of this content creator might not show up in your subscription feed. That's it. That's just how it goes. Danke für den Stream, sagt EW. Grüße aus Niedersachsen. Awesome. Freue ich mich sehr, dass du aus Niedersachsen zugeschaltet hast heute. Sehen wir uns nächstes Mal, denke ich. I just said, I hope I see EW back next time. Tuning in from Niedersachsen, Germany. Okay, guys. My name is OTHMARIUS, and this is just what I do. You be sure now that more magical stuff is going to be uploaded. More magical stuff, of course, is going to be uploaded very, very soon.
OTHMARIUS MAGIC.